Fun. All right, guys, here we go. From a dark basement in a haunted dwelling. It's been so hot and sweltering lately. Oh, I would just enjoy some cool breezes from some ghosts just flying past me and, you know, just bringing me some air. Somewhere in the black swamps of Northwest Ohio, this is Swamp Gas, and I'm Arizona Tramp. Oh, man, it's hot. I'm going to tell you what. First, my mic, 2 hours ago, I found out my mic took a crap on me. So I'm going and going and going trying to get this thing fixed. And guess what? It's working. I got it working. Almost had to cancel the show. And then it's like, oh, wait, let me try one more thing. So I did it. I also want to give out my shout out to PSN, to Chris, and to Angel, to Chris, because he brought me the awesome guest tonight. I'm going to tell you a little bit about her later. And to Angel, because PSN, his network. So we're on Black Swamp Radio. We're on PSN Live. It's awesome. Thanks, guys. Welcome to the family. We finally got this to work great. And, well, now I'm going to talk to you about some stuff that was pissing me off. The first hour is going to be dedicated to this. It can't be ignored, and I got to talk about it. I'm not a political show. Trust me, I'm not a political show. But this cannot be ignored. The things that I have found out within the last week, I need to discuss. And I'm going to. All right. The 15th of the month, which is Friday. In like 100 different cities throughout the United States, there are going to be Black Lives Matter rallies, whatever you want to call these things. The United States government, Obama has already said that the military and the cops can do what they have to. And I am looking at this could very possibly be what I've been talking about for a long time, which Obama declaring martial law. Because you know things are going to get out of hand. Just like last year, with the riots last year, it was the people from out of town. The people that said that they, the people that lived there, they all said these people weren't from around here that started these fires and started burning stuff and hurting people and so on. It's going to act like that again. They're going to use this for an excuse. I can see one piece of the equation not being in there to make things full-blown shit hits the fan. If they come out in the next 2 days and say that that police officer that shot that guy that worked at the school when he was sitting in his car before he even got a chance to get his seatbelt off or get his wallet out, and the cop just shot him, if they come out and say that that officer was in the right and that he still has his job, oh man, there's going to be some problems. There's going to be some major, major, major issues.
Are you okay?
No.
Good. That would be something very wrong if you were.
I am going to talk about a few subjects here tonight. If after I do this show tonight and I should disappear, you need to understand why. The statements I make tonight may implicate people in a way that the government may not like too well, and so they want to shut me up. However, the things I have to say need to be said, and I hope that they are listened to.
Don't play with that, you'll go blind.
First off, as for a cop's job, never mind that there are good and bad cops, because there always is. Do you have the balls to really do their job? So many times, every day in their line of work, they can be killed. And it does not have to be just from someone shooting them. Could you really do what they do? Could you go to work? Same for a fireman's job. Could you go to work, go to save someone and die? You never, ever, when you go to work as a cop, assume that you are going home. You hope that you get to go home. So do you really have the balls to do their job? I'm not sticking up for the cops here. I'm just asking you if you could do their job. Now, as far as bad cops go, and there seem to be many, they are allowed to act that way because they know or think they know that they can get away with treating people the way that they do. This has to stop. But until people put a stop to it, then it will continue to happen. What do I mean by allowing it to happen? Well, color and race is not what's important here. When you see a cop shoot an unarmed man, woman, or whatever, or you see someone taken down and treated excessively bad, and you stand around and do nothing but talk shit, you're part of the problem. Everyone needs to be held accountable for their actions. Like that guy that was on the ground. The guy that was on the ground, he was pinned. He could not move. Cop pulls out his gun and shoots his ass. Kills him. People did nothing but talk shit. That was fucking wrong. They needed to swarm those fucking cops. Not hurt them. Don't need to hurt them. Swarm them and hold them until other people could get there to take them away. Instead, you talk your shit, let the media run their mouth, twist things around. First it was said he was a legal carrying gun owner. Then it was said that the gun was illegal and that he was a felon. Which one are you going to believe? Or do you even really care until it's in your backyard or on your fucking doorstep? As far as the guy who worked at school and he had a legal carry permit and a gun, who was shot and killed, that cop had no business being there that day in the first place. What it comes down to is plain and simple as this. He was scared to death when he walked up to that car. and he let his mind run away with him. So he killed someone he really didn't mean to. That's what it comes down to. The guy was not mentally there to be a cop that day. Before the guy gets his words out, his whole complete fucking statement, sentence, whatever, the cop shoots him. Because the cop is in this frame of mind of, oh, well, this guy's going to shoot me. I need to shoot him first. He didn't need to fucking be there that day. He didn't need to be on the job that day. But the media's not going to tell you anything like this. Because it's the media's job to manipulate people and point them in a direction that the media and the people in power want you to go. We are being shown and we are seeing only what the people in power want us to see. There is no truth there. Every story shown is a lie. We are told one thing, then the next hour or day or days away, the story has completely changed and is twisted in some other way. And we as people who really don't care just allow it to continue, because if we did our jobs as citizens, it would impede on our lives, on our personal lives too much. And we can't have that. I want to play my Xbox. I want to walk around and do what I want to do on my cell phone. And I want to play my games. I don't really want to be a part of anything else. Let someone else do it. I have a game to play. So when you look at people and blame other people for the things that are going on, take a good hard look at yourself. Because it's always somebody else that should do it. You shouldn't worry about it. However, you cannot fight and stand up for what is right when you don't know what you're standing up for. When you believe what the media tells you, and they don't tell you the entire true story on anything, how can anyone do anything to change it? When everyone has been manipulated and race is an issue, then who do you trust? However, race is something I will not get into. But any one of you who knows me knows I will speak my mind and I will say the things that need to be said, and I don't care that it offends other people. The truth hurts, and as long as we keep stepping around things and worrying about if someone will offend someone, we will never get anything done. Yet this is another programming tool that is used by those people in power to put a roadblock in the way to keep things from taking place. But right back on the issue of color for a minute. The only time that it is acceptable for color to be an issue is when you're separating your clothes at the frickin' laundromat. Then there is a matter of allowing stories just to get overridden. What do I mean by that? Well, for once, every media and newsroom was talking to everyone about how Clinton should be indicted, how the FBI didn't do their job, how Hillary should not be allowed to run for president. Boom! The Dallas shooting happens. This shooting, according to my sources, was absolutely orchestrated to get the topic off Clinton so that she can quietly be put into power and voter fraud can be made, and voter fraud will not be made so apparent. Simple as that. I said it. And I mean it. And I believe 100% of what I just said. Media did not tell you that the guy that was shooting the cops was an American Muslim suffering from PTSD, because it did not fit into their agenda. They told you only what they wanted you to know. Never mind the fact that Clinton is above the law and that she can make things like this take place whenever she wants to. If you look back into the Clinton history, Hillary and her husband, you will find many people who have just been erased and disappeared over the last decades that ever got into their way.
think about it. So I ask you people, what are we going to do about this? This is true life we are living in, and these are true events. These are not, this is not anything that is conspiracy. The facts are right out in front of you if you care enough to do or notice anything about it. Do we put a stop to it? Or do we sit back and allow things to change to a point where soon it will make living in China look like a good thing?
Size matters not. Look at me. Judge me by my size, do you? And where you should not. For my ally is the Force. And a powerful ally it is.
Okay. The other thing about the games I want to get into real quick is Pokemon, this new Pokemon thing. There have been reports about how people are so into this game that they just walk into the middle of the street and almost get hit. This is what I'm talking about being controlled. They think about nothing else. Okay, if you have something that you want to talk about to me about what I just said, then call 1-419-464-7272. That is 419-464-7272. And if I pissed anybody off or offended somebody, I apologize. I had Tom Jensen in the room. He was listening. I guess he took off. He used to be a cop. I didn't say anything bad about cops, but I don't see anybody calling in. So anyway, that's okay. What needed to be said needed to be said. The atrocities that are taking place on both ends by people in power and people on the streets. The people on the streets that are going and walking through this Black Lives Matter stuff, a lot of them are some of the most violent and dangerous people in the country. They're going to tell you that Black Lives Matter because it was a white cop that shot a black guy. Well, what about the black guys that shoot white cops? Or I mean, that shoot the black officers that shoot white offenders. What about, I don't know. This is really disturbing. What about the blacks and the blacks? The blacks that go around. I just saw a story about how black kids in a gang decided to drive by and do a drive-by shooting, and a stray bullet went through somebody's front of the house, and a girl was eating her breakfast or dinner or whatever and was shot and killed by a stray bullet. It was black guys in the car that did it. And it was a black girl that died. And they're going to turn around and they're going to talk about how white people are being racist. And it's not just, nobody's being racist with the cops. They're doing their job. They do the same things to white people. The Mexicans, they do the same thing. They treat everybody like shit. They need to all, everyone needs to be held accountable, like I said. Everyone needs to be accountable. That's 1-419-464-7272. The things that bother me the most are the fact that nobody can get along and that nobody can trust anybody. It's just like I said on Future Theater 3 years ago. I told Nancy that aliens are not going to land. If the aliens landed in front of my house when I lived in the city, then the neighbors would come out with ball bats and guns and they would shoot them because they're different. And this, people can't get along. People don't trust anybody. Half of the reason people don't trust anybody is because they're manipulated into not trusting anybody. So the blacks don't like... I got a call. Let's see who this is. Hey, caller.
Hey.
Hey, it's Bear on the line.
Hey,
go for it, Bear.
Hey. Let me turn my radio down.
Yeah, turn your radio
block.
Down. Yeah.
Hey, this is Bear.
Yeah, I know. Go ahead there, Bear.
Hey, you know, the thing I wanted to kind of point out is, you know, we're all Americans. It doesn't matter what color, creed, religion, whatever. We're all Americans. We need to stick together as Americans and not play any of these hyphenated cards or whatever. You know, treat people like you want to be treated. And
well, the thing that scares me, Bear, is the 15th is when all these rallies and demonstrations are taking place. And united we stand, divided we fall. The 15th could very well be the day that we fall. And my prediction of Obama becoming king because he declares martial law takes place. And then we're really going to be in for it. But what else?
Especially when it's being sourced from outside the United States via George Soros, a lot of the stuff.
Well, yeah, it's being orchestrated, but from the normal person's view that does not take the time to look into anything, what else is Obama supposed to do? From all appearances on the outside, it looks like Obama's doing his job by doing that. And you don't want him to do that. And you don't want there to be race riots. You don't want to see people hurt. And the 15th, that's exactly what's going to happen. You're going to have thousands of people doing this, and most of these people are, you know, half-cocked in Looney Tunes in the first place. And there goes the train. Right? Do you agree with that, or...
Yeah, from what I could hear, you're cutting in and out. But, you know, I just wanted to, you know, say we shouldn't be having these issues. And the system should be working in a format that is palatable to everybody. You know, no division like there seems to be. It needs to get, you know, put back on the track because the train's been derailed.
I was really hoping Tom would call him.
Yeah, well, maybe he will. But I can see from, you know, the way the police treat people here, they're not very kind.
Oh, no, they're not kind at all. I watched a video. I don't know if you saw this particular video, but there is an 87-year-old lady. I don't know if she was black or white, and it doesn't matter. But she's walking through the parking lot. The police pull up, and they slam her to the ground, and all she has is her purse and a cane. And they slam her to an 87-year-old lady. Now, where is the call for that?
Well, I saw something similar the other day. There's an elderly lady, I don't know what her age is, but she was driving an RV, and they yanked her out of the RV so hard that they dislocated her shoulder. Okay? And she wasn't doing anything wrong or anything. She was just driving where they didn't want her to be driving. And so, anyway, you know, there's a lot of bad stuff going on. You know, excessive force, definitely.
Well, I saw a video of a kid that was in a car, and the cop came up and told him to get out of the car, and the kid's being a little smartass. You could tell he's being a little smartass, and the cop ends up tasing him. The kid ends up on the ground. He picks the cop picks the kid up, and then slams him on the ground. And supposedly the kid's in the hospital and has severe issues over being tased so long. And it's like, okay, well, you know, did the cop do his job? Could he have done something else during that time? From our perspective, things looked like he was being abusive. You know, but that's our perspective. We also have to remember, and like I said, does anybody really have the balls to do a cop's job? We weren't there. We don't know what took place before the video started.
Yeah, I think they all need to be wearing more secured cameras. And as you know, I was a first responder for many years, so...
Right.
You know, I know what it's like. I've been in the shoes. Anyway, that's my point of view on it. You know, we need to come together as Americans, not as a group or anything else, you know? You're here legally, that's great. You're not here, you know, if you're here illegally, you need to go home. Bye. See you later.
And that's what why people like Trump so well, because they make that, he makes that very same statement. But at the same time, how is Trump going to do that when he's got everybody else that's in power against that? So it's a pipe dream.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm having a real hard time hearing you because you're cutting in and out, but, you know, I just wanted to kind of give you my point of view on it.
Am I cutting in and out? How am I cutting in and out? Okay. All right. Thanks, Bear.
Hey, no problem, bro. I'll catch you later.
All right. I'll see you back.
Bye-bye.
All right. Anybody else out there listening to the show see that I was cutting in and out? And anyhow, I am just waiting now for my guest to call in. And my guest is Brenda Harvey Harris. She should be calling in here in a minute. And she is a Native American who lives on a reservation in New Mexico. She began investigating Bigfoot in the early 90s and started a team in 2011 called New Mexico Shadow Seekers. She has also been on Monsters and Mysteries, also Finding Bigfoot, also the Finding Bigfoot show, and have been on several radio shows. She learned of Sasquatch at a very young age on Navajo Hour on KNDN radio station in Farmington, New Mexico. Back in the 70s. Ever since then, she's taken an interest in Bigfoot. So that's who my guest is. So until my guest gets here, if anybody wants to talk about Bigfoot, that's all cool. If anybody else has anything else that they want to talk about, that's a good thing too. If anybody wants to stay on this issue about what's going to be going on Friday, because that bothers me. I can see nothing good happening on Friday. Things start with good intentions, and then somebody decides that they're going to throw stones, and stones turn into bricks. And bricks turn into Molotov cocktails, and riots ensue. And when you have that many cities doing that much stuff, there's going to be issues. Anyhow. Maybe I should just go ahead and I should play a song. I'll play it. That's what I'll do. I'll go ahead and I'm going to play a song since she, for some reason, hasn't called in. And we are regrouped and we will be back. Oh.
to the vortex reality. Release into the dream.
My guest.
Yes, it is.
Awesome. It has been one of those days for me. Let me tell you what, man. yeah. Anyway, so I hope you are doing well and having a decent night.
Yes, I'm doing excellent.
Okay. So you are Native American and you live on a reservation in New Mexico. Which tribe are you with?
The Navajo.
Oh, mm-hmm. That's awesome. When I lived in Sedona, I used to talk with Hopi and some Navajo. So.
Nice.
Yeah, it's beautiful up there, I'll tell you. So, Brenda.
Yeah.
What got you started into this Bigfoot deal?
Well, it goes back, you know, at a young age. When I first heard, you know, the name Sasquatch on the Navajo Hour, you know, at that time I didn't know what a Sasquatch was until, you know, the lady would, you know, say, don't go down at the river. And of course, I would ask my mom and dad, what is she talking about and what is a Sasquatch? And they would just tell me, oh, just go to sleep. It's nothing. And I'll wake you up when we get to grandma's. I said, okay, you know, and then as I got into my teens, there was a movie that came out in The Legend of Boggy Creek. And when I went and watched this movie, you know, at the beginning of the movie, you know, they would be talking about it. And then I remember the guy saying the name Sasquatch. And then I remembered at a young age, I've heard that name before. I remember that lady on Navajo Island would say that name. And I'm sitting there up, you know, what is a Sasquatch? And then they would later on in the movie, of course, they would show, you know, what it was, and it was just big old tall, hairy creature. And I'm like, wow, that's what the lady is talking about on the radio station, and that's running down at the river. You know, I was surprised, you know, at when I was sitting there watching the show. But you know, that's from, you know, from that young of an age, you know, I start getting curious, more curious into it. Then I would start hearing some things. And then I married in 86 and moved out onto the reservation. And, well, there was activity going on. And, you know, we had one that would come around the house and, you know, bother us at night. And of course, I didn't know that that's what it really was, you know, at that time. I'm like, oh, you know, they stay in the mountains. In my mind, that's what I'm thinking, in the mountains. But, you know, this thing would turn the doorknob and, you know, open the screen door and then turn the doorknob, and the dogs would be whimpering and stuff like that underneath the porch, and they wouldn't come out. And I'm like, okay, you know, I have my brother there with me, one of my own brothers, and I had my kids there, and, you know, I told him, be quiet, I hear something. And that's when we noticed that it was on the porch. And it started turning the doorknob. I'm like, oh, gosh, what is this? And it was about 11 o'clock, between 10:30, because my husband had left for grave at about 10:30 at night. And about 30 minutes, 15, 30 minutes later, this thing was on the porch. And the thing that really caught my attention was the dogs were really barking and crying underneath the porch. And when it started turning the doorknob, I told my brother, oh, my God, what is it? Someone trying to just scare us. you know, I tried to get him to open the door, and he was so frozen. He was just scared. You know, we were all scared because we didn't know what it was. And I tried to get him to open the door, swing it open, and he just couldn't move. So I got the courage enough to deadlock the door. And once he heard the click, I could hear it let go of the door, the screen door. And it started taking out. I heard him swing the door open, and there it was running off the porch. It was tall. What we seen was very tall. And, it was at night, so the hair looked black from head all the way down to the foot. And this one wasn't very muscular. It was that kind of, not real skinny, you know, not real thin, but it was kind of small, but very tall.
Well, how tall was this thing?
I want to say at least about between 7 to 8 feet tall. It was pretty tall.
So it's 7 to 8 feet tall. It's hairy. It's kind of scrawny, is what you're calling?
Yeah, I guess you could say scrawny looking. You know, it wasn't really muscular. I mean, like nowadays I've seen some that are very muscular, very big. And this one that I've seen, you know, very, very first time like that, I was like, oh, wow. You know, they're there. You know, they're out here. You know, and I was surprised, really. It kind of caught me off guard. I thought it was just someone, you know, just trying to scare us.
The only noise it made was turning the doorknob. It didn't make any noise, and it ran.
It was breathing. It had like you could hear it breathing, real like a heavy, really heavy breathing, but some deep breathing. You know, like that.
Well,
but deeper. And I'm like,
right.
Whoa, what is that? You know, and I'm like, because I had the screen windows, the windows open. You know, you had the screen there, so I could hear it. And that's how I could hear the dogs whimpering, crying. And I'm like, whoa, what the heck?
You didn't smell anything?
When I went outside, you could smell. It had a really like a musky smell, rotten, just some dead, just a really horrible smell.
Kind of like a skunk?
It kind of, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, just a mixture of all of that. It smelled horrible.
Right. So, you went from this to starting a paranormal Bigfoot group?
Yes, back in, I've been doing the investigation and stuff and you know, really checking into stuff for a long time. I've never said anything. I kept it quiet for my family, for my friends. You know, I've just been really, really quiet about it until 2000, I believe it was 9 and 10. We had some incidents that happened out here back then, when they had we had something coming around the area killing sheep, and I had a lady had found out what I was doing. Several people did, and they had called me to the one of the workers, employees at the chapter house. The manager called me and asked me to come out to the chapter house. I have a grandma here that wants to talk to you. So I went over there and I spoke with her, and she was in tears, asking me to come out to her place to check because something had killed her sheep. And, you know, she was in tears. I had two grandmas at different times, you know, come and check, you know, this Bigfoot thing is killing our sheep. Can you kill it? I'm getting tired of it taking our livestock. Excuse me. And I said, okay, I'll be out there. From that point on is when I formed a team. You know, that, well, you know, something needs to be done, and that's when I actually formed an actual team. But as far as, like, investigating on my time and all and researching, I've been doing that for a very long time, back in the 90s, 90s into, not 90s, in the late 80s is when
okay.
I actually started way back then, but actually finally started itching back in 2011.
So the Bigfoot was killing sheep, so it's aggressive enough to kill sheep, but when it's up there on the doorstep, it just runs away when y'all go towards the door. That's interesting to me. You know? Hello? Hello? Oh, well, I guess we've lost our guest. We lost our guest. Oh, here we go. Yeah, it's one of those nights, isn't it? It's okay.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you. I mean, so the call got dropped, you know, stuff happens.
Yeah.
But I was saying, so when it's on your porch, it runs off, but it's got the cojones enough to be able to kill sheep so it can eat.
Right. Exactly.
That's
what it wanted at that time, you know, when it was like trying to get into the door. I mean, these things are so big and very strong, they could easily, you know, just bust down the door and come in, but it didn't.
What kind of evidence?
Why it kept doing what it did? I don't know.
What kind of evidence did it leave? I mean, with as far as the sheep?
It left a footprint behind the house.
It left a single footprint killing sheep, huh? Wow. You love her? Yeah.
Well, we had what was killing the sheep at that time. Not only do we have Bigfoot, but there was something else that was killing the sheep. Now, when Bigfoot doesn't kill, especially on a livestock, you know, they'll just rip right into it.
Okay.
And what was killing the grandma sheep was something different. And what it was doing was just sucking the blood out of the sheep and the goats. What it left on the sheep was a puncture wound in the neck. And then what was really wild was it had a little, like a surgical cut on its abdomen, and all the insides, they were all hanging out, but didn't touch any of that.
That reminds me, I can't remember the goat sucker or whatever. I can't remember the name of what I want to say. Out of Mexico and stuff. You know where I'm going.
What they call the chupacabra?
Chupacabra. That's what it is. That's what that reminds me of, is chupacabra.
Mm-hmm.
But, what all do you do when you go out and do your searching for Bigfoot?
Well, the first thing, when people call me, I'll go out, you know, on site and, you know, listen to what they have to say. And there's several things that I always look out for. One is why, you know, you always want to find out why is it coming to the property. The first thing that I usually look for is food, animal food, dog food, cat food, livestock feed. Is that all being left out where they can be reached, you know, where they can no worse end, they'll come and get it. They eat that stuff. So I tell the people, now if I see that, you know, laying out there, if there's leftovers, I'm like, okay, they're eating on them. Then sometimes a lot of the people will say, yeah, we notice our livestock food is going down fast. Our cat food, our dog food is going down really fast. Well, that's the first thing that I usually look for. I'm like, okay, that's something you need to put that up, because they are coming and eating that. They like that stuff, livestock food. That has cat corn in there. They love the corn. That's what they'll eat too. And that's one thing I tell them to do, is get that stuff put up. Another thing is during the harvest time is when they usually come out quite a bit. I mean, a lot out here in our area, because they eat, you know, all the foods are there harvest time. From fall all the way into throughout the whole summer, from that time on, there's no more harvest food, so they'll come out more, so they're hungry, and that's when they start attacking the animals. They want something to eat, so we come up, a lot of people will come up with their small animals taken, they're gone. They like the chickens, the ducks, the cats and the dogs, ducks and rabbits, you know, they'll eat all of that. Even they'll even kill a horse, also cows. You know, they're hungry, so that's what they're going to go after too, sheep, you know, new livestock that they can get their hands on. So that hunger, they will attack them and take them and eat them.
How often do you have cases like this?
I get pretty much year round.
Really?
Yes.
Because it seems to me, okay, what's the difference between a Bigfoot doing this and a coyote or a wolf coming in?
I look for the tracks. And a lot of the times, I don't see the coyote tracks or the wolf tracks or a pack of wild dog tracks. I find more of the Bigfoot tracks, the footprints that are around in the corral, around the house, around the property.
Okay. So you find multiple tracks and...
Yes.
Is there a certain way that Bigfoot goes about a kill compared to, let's say, a wolf or a coyote or a cat?
They're pretty much almost, you know, they walk up on it, you know, so just like how what you just mentioned, the cows and carcass, you know, they walk up on them really quietly and grab and take. Well, that's what the Bigfoot does too.
Really? So they just walk up, snatch it, and walk off.
Oh yeah.
They don't bother.
We had one that did that a couple three years ago. I had gotten a call, and I was on my way to out of town, and a lady had called me, and I said, "Hey, I'm watching Bigfoot right now. He's got something white in both arms, and he's carrying it. And it looks like it stopped. There's two Bigfoots," and she was watching this thing, both of them walking along the mesa there down below. And she says, "Carrying something white." She goes, "Oh my God, I think it's carrying the sheep." And this was about 10:30, 11 o'clock in the morning when I got the call, and she was watching it, and she was telling me, and I heard and got a hold of one of my teammates, and I sent him down there, Dave Oz, and he's the one that took footage of this. And what it was doing, she said, before he got there, there was actually two of them, and they were walking, and it walked into this, along the mesa there, and down below the river, just above the river, and it was carrying something white. Now, she said earlier that morning, about 9 o'clock in the morning, she heard her neighbors, they were shooting a gun. And she figured, and then when she seen this thing walking from where her neighbor was along the mesa there down below, and it was walking to the west, she seen two of them, and then one of them disappeared behind the hill there, and this one that was carrying something white, they walked down around this hill there, and then one of them popped back up, and it was walking back to the east, as if maybe it was going back to the other one, possibly a sheep, and it did it. She said, it looks like it's carrying a sheep from, you know, what she was looking at. And every time it would walk, it would stop, and it would, like, do something to its leg. And, you know, it walked so far, and it stopped again, and it would bend over, and it looked like it was, I don't know, maybe rubbing its leg or something. But, oh, and she's like, "I bet that gunshot was her neighbor was shooting at it, and it must have got the leg."
So, yeah,
it sounds like each time it would walk, you know, because they said this thing, that they had been missing some sheep out of the corral. And apparently they must have saw it that morning in the corral taking the sheep, and that's when they started shooting, and it must have got it in the leg.
So it doesn't matter about whether it's day or night. They just go in and take what they want.
Yeah, they'll take what they want. You know, they're hungry, you know. You're not going to get it back. Just let them have it.
Does this happen all over or just on the reservation?
I'm sure it's happened all, you know, pretty much all over, not just on the reservation. It's different parts of the states that they're going through something like this, I'm sure.
Well, your story, I have not heard your story as far as Bigfoot being as active as I'm hearing. And so this is new to me. This is interesting. And it seems to me that with what you're describing, sooner or later, we should have a Bigfoot should be recognized as something real, because a hunter or a farmer is going to end up shooting it for stealing its wild animals their sheep or whatever.
Yeah.
Their livestock. Yeah.
Mhm. Yeah, it's pretty active out this way. You know, we had early last summer, had a lady in the same area where the sheep was taken. One of the ladies out there, her neighbor next door, right next door, was working out in the field, and this was 9 o'clock in the morning. She's working in her field, you know, in her garden, hoeing the garden there, and she just had this eerie feeling something was watching her, and she stopped and looked down to the south of her field, and there was two of them standing right there watching her. You know, this is something that I share with the people, is, you know, especially to the ladies and the little kids, you know, be very, very careful, because they really observe the women. Be careful out there. They like to hear the laughter of the kids, you know, and they try to imitate the kids, because they, of course, they have their little ones too. So they try to imitate what we do and what the young kids do too as well. There was another incident last summer. I think it was last summer. Same area. And there was a gentleman that was working his field about half a mile from where this lady had seen two of them. Well, he had popped a tent in his field there, and was just going to, you know, camp there and for the summer and work his farm. Well, he didn't do anything, you know, just popped a tent that night, got in, call it a night. Went into his tent, must have been about, what, I think 1 o'clock in the morning, they were telling me that this thing came and drug him, picked him up with his tent, and was dragging him back down towards the river. And the guy wasn't doing anything but, you know, sleeping in his tent. You know, this area is pretty active. And why was it taking him back down to the river? We don't know. Was he going to eat him, kill him, possibly? I don't know.
Well,
and he said that he fought and kicked and yelled, and, you know, and this thing finally let go, and he got out of that thing, and he ran back, you know, to the field, and he jumped on his truck, they said, and he never came back. He'll go out there during the day to work the field, but he will not stay there at night.
Wow, that sounds like he was a lucky man.
Yes, he was. So that terrified him. That really scared him.
Did you give any thought the other day as to what I said as far as what if Bigfoot is a skinwalker?
You know, a lot of people say that. It could be, but I don't think so. My honest opinion, no.
You don't believe so?
No.
It was just, you've had different. More experience than I have with Bigfoot, okay? So I just, it was something that crossed my mind, and so I thought I would ask you or, you know, or somebody else that actually knows more than I do about it. That's all.
No, you know. No, it's something different, way different from a skinwalker.
Right. It sounded kind of different than a skinwalker as far as I was concerned myself. Mm-hmm. But it was an idea I had, so I thought I'd throw it out there, you know. Into...
Oh, yeah, doesn't hurt you.
So, what else do you do in the paranormal field other than Bigfoot?
So I mainly focus on the Bigfoot because that's what's going on right now. As far as like the skinwalker, I don't really deal with that because it's nothing but witchcraft. And it's sad that a lot of the natives use that against one another, you know, among the families and stuff like that. And I really don't deal with that. You know, I mainly focus on the Bigfoot and other things that are out there roaming, you know, the area. like the thing that was killing the sheep that, you know, just blew us away. You know, I'm like, that's not a Bigfoot kill. That's totally something different. I mean, what can drag a 300-400-pound ram out of its corral and sit on top of it, from what I gather, is that it just shoved its head so far into the ground, you know, punctured room in the neck, and did the same slit on the side and sucked out all the blood. You know, when I went and looked at this ram, and that there was so much dirt in the mouth and in the nostrils and in the eyes, and I'm like, wow, this is a ram. And I'm like, wow, what could do that?
Well, yeah.
You know, yeah, it could be a big, back in the, I could see a Bigfoot dragging it out, but no, this is something else. You know, like I said, a Bigfoot, when it kills a sheep, I've seen some that have been ripped up pretty bad.
The chupacabra, everybody says that the chupacabra is about the size of a dog. But in order for a chupacabra to be able to do what it does to animals, it's going to be a lot bigger.
It has to be bigger.
You just described it. My next question is, what do you describe to me the process when you show up at some place there and you have to determine whether or not it was a Bigfoot or whether it was another animal? What all do you do to determine this?
What I look for is the footprints. Was it a dog? You know, was it a coyote? Those, I always look for the tracks.
Do you take...
If there's a big footprint, then it was a Bigfoot that I, you know, I mean, I found some footprints that measure from 12 inches to 16 to 17 inches long. Some of them are 4 inches wide.
Do you take plastic casts of this?
Oh, yes. I take casts as we measure them, and we date them and stuff like that. Yes, we do.
Do you ever find hair and whatnot?
Yes, we find hair as well.
Do you ever take this hair and try to get it analyzed?
Yes.
Where have you tried to get this stuff analyzed from?
I send them out to different people to get them analyzed. I'd rather not give out the names right now.
Well, that's fine. You don't have to give the names. That's just mm-hmm. fine. So you have done all that.
Yes. All the time. You know, it's the first thing that I look for is the tracks. Okay, let me see the tracks. If it's a Bigfoot, if it's maybe a pack of dogs or a wolf or a coyote, then
is there a difference?
It would be that.
Can you physically hold the hair of what you think is a Bigfoot? Is the hair different than human or animal than that you know of?
Yeah, it's not. You know how the horse hair is,
yeah.
Right? It's not horse hair. It's a little different from the human hair. Human hair, a lot of it's some of it's fine, and some of it's what do you call it, coarse. Bigfoot's, you know, almost like in between the coarse and the I can't think of the word right now. But and the pretty kind of long reddish brown. Some of them have like a little wave to them, I guess you could say. I don't know how else to describe it. You know, some, like I said, are long, reddish brown and black. I've come across some horse hair. You know how horse hair is, and they're really long. And some of them are not too long. You know, I'm like, well, that's horse hair. It's
right.
Always kind of like compared to the horse. Maybe a cow hair, you know how those are.
Well, I'm thinking of, is it coarse?
It's in between, like, the coarse hair that, you know, from what I've been finding.
Okay. Yeah, my mic. I'm sorry if you're having trouble understanding what I'm talking about here. My mic is. I had to replace the mic with a backup mic tonight. Things are not too cool at the moment. But anyway.
Yeah, it kind of sounds different. So I'm trying to pick up what you're saying.
Well, that, and I'm trying to not eat the mic. But eat the mic, if you know what I'm saying.
Right. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I have to. I don't know. Anyhow. What other? Is there anything else other than footprints and other than hair that is evidence of a Bigfoot that you find?
Handprints. Very long. Fingers are very long. Sometimes they're left on the window. From it, looking in the window. Sometimes I'm getting reports. Lately I've been getting quite a few reports of it slapping the side of the house. And it leaves like long scratches along the side of the house.
Okay.
I really listened to what the eyewitness informs me of what they've seen. You know, start from there, and then from there, you know, what they've seen, what they've heard, which way did it go, or what, sure, was it a dog, you know, a coyote running, oh no, you know, and that's when I start taking on, and I'll go look around these areas, and I'll find a footprint. I'll find a tall, you know, a branch broken up high in the tree, you know, 6 feet, and then above will be broken. Those are things that I look for before, you know, like I said, before I actually determine that's a Bigfoot. The main thing is the footprint. That's the main thing that I look for. Also, what the people, what they have encountered, what they, you know, share with me.
Right.
You know, those are the things that I really, really look into before I actually say, okay, that was a Bigfoot.
Okay, well, we're at the top of the hour. I'm going to go ahead and play a song. You can go run and grab yourself a drink of water or something like that, and we will be right back about 60 seconds or whatever.
Okay.
Black Swamp Radio apparel now at Tee Public. Available on the Black Swamp Radio main page. Get your Black Swamp Radio t-shirts at Tee Public. You can go to the main page of Black Swamp Radio and find the link there. And we are back. Had to regroup, gather my thoughts there a little bit, which, you know, it's one of those nights. And I apologize if I'm not at the top of my game. I don't want to sound like Art Bell, but you know, my back went out two nights ago, and I'm fighting that right now so I could sit here in this chair. So anyhow, where else do you... You said you mainly stay on the reservation, and... where else would you go, or do you stay in New Mexico for your investigations, or do you go?
Oh no, I go pretty much all over. I've been out there in Arizona quite a bit, and in Colorado. I've been out in those areas as well. you know, I get a lot of calls, you know, if something's bothering our animals, you know, can you come out and check? And that's what I'll do, you know, I'll go out there. Even out here in Farmington, about 10 miles of where I'm at in Upper Fruitland area. I even get calls from the Farmington area along the rivers there. Colorado state line, they get calls out that way as well.
So it, from your part of New Mexico, is it just, you know, basic desert? Or is there forest there? Because I'm, from what I understand about Bigfoot, Bigfoot loves the forest.
Oh, yes. Where I'm at right now, yeah, on the reservation, like I said, I live in an area where there's a lot of farmland. And, you know, everybody thinks it's the you say reservation, everybody's assuming it's desert. But no, it's some places are desert. But where I'm at, I live about half a mile from the river, the main river. And there's a lot of trees and a lot of farm fields out here. And so it's got a lot of greenery, a lot of trees out here, so along the river. So that's where we're having a lot of the activity.
So
along the Animas and San Juan rivers.
A lot of space for it to hide. Do you ever hear it? Do you ever hear it scream? Have you ever heard a Bigfoot scream?
Oh, yeah. Yes, I have. Several times.
Want to curl your skin?
Oh, yes. Yep. It's like, wow, that was loud. That one was a loud one. And the whoops are very loud.
Right. So mm-hmm. when a Bigfoot screams, do you see or hear anything out of it after that? Or is that basically like a call to say, okay, there's humans around, I don't want to be there, or what?
No, a lot of the times when they yell like that, it's like they're trying to call out to the other ones, like, hey, I'm over here. You know, like, and they'll get another I'll hear another yell, but it's coming maybe way from the east side, and one way over here on the west, and so I hear another yell coming from the east, and it's like they're communicating, like, hey, I'm over here, you know, where are you at, you know, and yeah, I hear that quite a bit.
So it's
a lot
more
of communication,
of a,
like going on between the.
It's more of a communication thing, the screen.
Yeah.
Okay.
And sometimes I hear a yell that sounds, it really sounds like it's really lonely, like a loud, lonely cry. And boy, the dogs will just go off
like
all
where,
at once.
Like, where is everybody?
I guess you could say that. But yeah, this cry sounds, it's a sad cry. I've heard that before.
Right. A sad cry. I've only heard that one cry that I heard on Art Bell that one night. And I think that's the only... a couple of people have played that same MP3. That's the only time I've ever heard it cry.
Oh, wow.
And so anyway...
their yells, it's very powerful. It really is. I mean, if you're just right there in the middle of it, it is powerful. I mean, you could just feel the vibration coming off your chest. It's like, wow.
There's no mistaking what that is.
That's right. I mean, there's no animal that could do that. It's like, wow, this is crazy, you know, this is amazing. I'm just like, wow, I'm just standing there listening. I'm like,
you don't
what's
happen
he gonna
to
do?
You don't happen to have the opportunity to have any audio of that sort of thing, do you?
I have some on our New Mexico Shadow Seekers on YouTube. I believe there's a couple of them on there, and we're getting ready to to release another audio. And this one is a little bit louder than the ones that we've had. So this one was a pretty loud one.
And
I went on, when we did the recording that night, as soon as we parked, bam, I mean, it just started going off. Like, wow, I mean, this was probably on my left hand, on my right hand side. I'm going to say about at least maybe 70 to 80 yards away from us. And it was loud. And I, fumbling around, you know, we had just barely parked, opened the window, and it just starts going off. It starts yelling. And I'm scrambling around for my recorder, but luckily my son, he ended up just using his cell phone recording the whole thing. And we sat there probably for about a good maybe hour, because it would sound off for about a good 10 minutes, and then it would stop. And you could hear it walking, you know, walking to the south. And then it'd go off way to the south. And then about 20 minutes later, it's making its way back to where we were at, and it goes off again. It's like, wow. And it was loud. We were actually surprised, you know.
So
it was yelling kind of early that night. Yeah, we were out in the mountains when we took this recording.
Okay, so where can I hear that? What's the address so I can go to see
This one, my son is downloading it here. He's working on that. And I said we'll post it until tomorrow, late tomorrow afternoon.
Okay.
So once I get we get it up, I'll give you a message like, hey, it's up, and I'll give you the name of the audio is what we're going to put it under.
All right. But is there a URL to a website? Do you have a website? Where?
Yes, it's New Mexico Shadow Seekers. Got some videos out.
New Mexico Shadow.
On YouTube. Mm-hmm.
New Mexico Shadow Seekers on
Shadow
YouTube.
Shadow Seekers.
So I just go to YouTube, type in New Mexico Shadow Seekers, and
yes.
I'll be taken right there.
Yes.
That's awesome. Yeah. Do send me the URL to that tomorrow so that I can post it along with the podcast.
Sure.
The podcast will be up tomorrow afternoon sometime. And so do these sightings happen only when it's nice out, or does it matter whether there's snow on the ground or whether there's whether it's storming out or anything like that?
They mainly come out on, you know, fairly nice days. They don't like the heat, but they'll still come out if they have to. During a rainstorm, windstorm, they'll come out. They'll use that to their advantage. Snow, they will still come out because they're hungry. So they'll make their way out. So really it doesn't matter, you know. They use some of these weather to their advantage, especially the wind. So they can move around, you know, more without the... Because you can't really hear them moving when the wind's blowing. So they use that to their advantage.
Well, yeah, that would make sense. When all the trees and everything is rustling around...
Right.
It masks the noise. And you can't find them. Do you have any photographs on your website? Showing Bigfoot, or do you, you know?
I have one video out that something, what was it called? I'm sorry, I forget the name. It's something like pops up by the pool. This one was, you know, really a strange one. This happened back in 2009. Like I said, I had known that, you know, this thing was coming around, but I didn't realize that it was actually coming to the house. We had a swimming pool that, you know, we had set up one summer back in 2009, and we noticed the water was, you know, going down quite a bit. I'm like, well, something must be drinking the water or something. So we set up the video camera in the house in the window there, and let it play. And the next day that I went to go check the video, something, you know, looks like a young one. You know, it like comes up. You know, we don't know. I'm not too sure which way it comes up, from the north or the east. When I set up this video camera, a little mini video camera, it's not a night vision camera, but you can open the exposure where it can pick up, you know, images.
Right.
Well, and I had left the screen on the window, and so it would focus in, out, you know, clear, and then focus again. And but it did pick up what looks like maybe a young one. And just from watching the video, almost looks as if it just boiled up from the ground, and then it took off to a running stance to the west. That's on the on YouTube, and you can check that video out as well. I think it was called The Late Night Visitor. I think that's what we called that video. So you could check that one out as well.
Would you mind if I open it up for questions?
That's fine.
Okay. If anybody has a question for Brenda about Bigfoot and so on, you can call in to 419-464-7272 and give her your questions. Anyhow, I am like almost out of questions here. I was not expecting, I was expecting to have you for the second hour, and then it turned out that I needed to have you on for an hour and a half because the person that was supposed to be on with me during the first hour couldn't make it. Now, I don't know what's going on with this show lately. it's one thing after another. That's not your problem, but... Anyhow, if I was in New Mexico and I had an issue about what's going on with Bigfoot, or I have a sighting or something like that, how do I get in contact with you so that I can either have you show up, or so that I can just send you what I saw or send you video or whatever?
I usually give them my email address, or they can look me up on Facebook. I used to give out my phone number, but
I
get a lot of prank calls, so I don't even do that anymore. So my email address is the one that I mainly use, and Facebook message.
So, put out your, if you want to put out your email address, that's cool. Okay. Phone numbers, no, don't do a phone number. That's
no, I won't do that. My email address is harrisbrenda46@yahoo.com. And like I said, you can also find me on Facebook.
Okay. And Facebook is, I don't remember the address. Your Facebook would be?
It just look up my name, Brenda Harvey Harris.
Ah, okay, Brenda Harvey Harris. That would be your Facebook. Like I said, I'm not. I don't know. So
yeah,
I apologize.
Well, I could share with you with what I've been sharing with the people.
Well, go for it.
When this first kind of exploded around here. Back in 2009, of course, a lot of the people, the community, they've known about it. You know, among the Navajo people, you don't talk about this. You just leave it alone, let it do what it needs to do, and it won't bother you. And that saying is true, just leave it alone. And after the sheep, killing and stuff like that, and, I had the grandmas coming up to me and crying and asking me to kill this, get rid of it. And, I thought, something needs to be done. And so I had brought it before the chapter officials at that time. I'm like, hey, this is what's going on. Is it okay if I can talk before the people and share with some of the things that could possibly help, if they could do some of these things, maybe it'll help and these things will go elsewhere. you know, and they, you know, they were really hesitant at first because they didn't want me to give the chapter house and the officials a bad name. You know, like I said, this is just something you just don't talk about.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And they understood, and they went ahead and gave me the okay. So I went before the chapter, the meeting, and I spoke and, you know, shared with them what some of the things that you could do. And the first thing that I told the people to do is light. Get some light. Light is your best friend. Now, when I moved out here back in 86, hardly anybody didn't have any street lights at the time. Yeah, there's a few here and there, and some people would leave their porch lights on. You know, many didn't have to.
Right, it's so pitch black.
You come out here now, ever since this has been going on, and you're getting the word out, and we're getting out, you know, to many other people who get some more light out. We've got a lot of families out here now that have really lit up their property with, some of them have two or three street lights, and that's good because they don't like light. But I also tell them, be aware because they are coming out in the light as well. So be careful anyway. But the more light you have, the better. That's the first thing that I had shared with them. Another thing is, like I said earlier, if you have cat food, dog food, livestock feed, and there's leftovers at night, get that stuff put up. Feed your animals before it gets dark. Whatever leftovers there is, get that stuff put up so they won't come around and eat that, and they'll go elsewhere to look for food. And another thing is, I advise people not to feed these things because, and a lot of people don't agree with me, but I tell them don't feed them because once you start feeding them, they're going to expect it every time. And if you don't feed it, okay, we had a lady down here that was feeding it, and she'd gone on vacation, and this thing got mad and just rampaged her in the backyard. Even though you leave food maybe half a mile from where you live, and you're thinking that they don't know where you live, well, guess what? They are watching, and they'll follow you. They know your scent, that the scent that you carry. They'll follow that back to your house. Well, in this case, that's what happened. This Dick had followed this lady back to her house without her knowing, and she was gone for about a week. And when she came back, she went back down there to leave food, and she noticed that by the river was all messed up. Where she leaving the food, like something got mad and threw things around, and then noticed behind her house, right behind her yard, you know, in her backyard, things were thrown around. And this thing was looking for food. It got mad, and there was no food. And I tell people, don't leave the food out like that because that's what they'll do. Another thing is if you have abandoned old sheds or, you know, buildings that you're not using, get rid of those. You know, if they're not in use, because they use that to hide in, to shelter in. Also, people, you know, sometimes late at night I'll hear gunshots going off. Could be possibly bothering, you know, the neighbors down the road, and they're getting tired of it, so they start shooting. Another thing is, I tell the people, don't shoot at it because they usually travel in groups. And if you hit it, you're gonna, another one might come and charge at you rather than shooting it, because also you got to look at the people that live around you. With that bullet straying, guess what? You're in trouble if it hits an individual, a human. You know, you're going to be liable for that. So I usually tell them, hey, use a firecracker. You know, light that and throw it out there, and that'll scare them off too because it sounds like a gun.
Right.
And another thing is, if you hear something, you know, comes around your house and is, you know, playing the doorknob or chapping at the window, another thing that you could use also is, if you have a car alarm in your car and you have a panic button on your key, your remote there to your car, hit that panic button because the horn and all of that will go off and the lights will go off on that car. That also scares them off too, and they'll take off running. and well, you
that
know
that sounds like it would things make like sense that. But mm-hmm. what about just a plain old sensor on your light, motion detector sensor? I mean, would that work?
Oh yeah, that'll work too. But another thing is, I tell, you know, if you have a game cam, set that up. They don't like game cams. They know what that is. They don't walk in front of that. They'll go all the way around, or, you know, they'll come in another area. Usually times they'll go elsewhere. Another thing is, I tell them, if you have to go outside at night, always carry some kind of weapon, or make sure you go in a group. Carry a flashlight with you. You know, everybody is always so focused and looking down on the ground for footprints, you know, and stuff like that at night. And then I tell them, if you have a cottonwood tree, because cottonwood trees out here are pretty big, I said, look up in the trees, because they're sitting up there in the trees watching you. And they're like, oh my God, are you kidding? You know, I had a family out here that, you know, didn't quite really believe me that they sit in the trees. Well, I happened to be just there that night, you know, talking with this family, and the neighbor calls and tells them, hey, something's bothering your sheep. They're going wild in the corral. So we all took off outside, and this family, you know, had been having some problems with this Bigfoot coming around their property. And we all took off outside, and lo and behold, you know, you can see the sheep, they're really running around in the corral, and we're all, everybody's shining the lights all over the place in the back. And I noticed a tree in the back, and this was at night. I said, shine the light in that tree. And lo and behold, there was sitting in the tree, we got red eyes shine, two of them. And they couldn't believe it, and it was just, you know, it was just right there, you know. And they were just, you know, shocked. They couldn't believe it. And so when we put more light onto it, it jumped off the tree and ran back to the south.
I have never heard that Bigfoot sits up in a tree. That's the first time I've ever heard that.
Yeah, we have some young ones that do sit up in the tree. The juveniles, they'll do that. They'll sit up in the tree.
And
that's one thing that I tell the people is, look up in the tree at night. You know, if you're hearing something and, you know, they're hiding or whatever, I said, shine the light up in the tree. They're probably sitting up there.
So these reality Bigfoot shows don't really tell you nothing compared to what's really going on.
Exactly right. Another thing I stress to the people is the ladies. You know, don't go out there at night by yourself. Always try to have someone out there. The kids, you know, always tell them, don't let them run down towards the river by themselves. You know, always keep an eye on your kids, because they really watch the women and the kids. People always ask me, has it kidnapped a kid before? Yes, it has. It has.
Well, do they eat the kids, or what do they do?
I believe they do. This happened back in the 60s and 70s. When my grandma was taking her grandkids to the trading post, and she was driving the truck, and she had her kids in the back of the bed, and pretty soon the kids are yelling at the grandma, 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 the monster's coming, he's coming. And, you know, she's going down the road, and she's like, what are you talking about, you know? And grandma, grandma, and the kids are all screaming in the back of the bed, the monster's coming, he's right here, you know? And it scooped out one of the kids out of the back of the bed of the truck, and it turned around, ran back up into the mountains. And it was a little girl that it took, and they never found that little girl. And then in the 70s, pretty much the same thing happened, but it was a little boy, and they never found him either. And so I tell the people to really watch your kids, and, you know, because they do. They'll kidnap them and never to be found.
I have never heard about this in the States. I heard about it over in Tibet, but I never heard about that here.
It's happened on the reservation.
That's disturbing.
Back in the 60s and 70s.
When I was in Sedona, and nobody ever told me in detail like this either. It was like, mm-hmm. wow. So I have to thank you for letting me know some stuff and my listeners, some stuff that is like brand new to me.
Yeah, things that I share, these are some of the things that I share with the people that it has really helped them quite a bit. You know, when I was telling them, if you can, when I go and check out these areas, people invite me to come onto the property to check their livestock. First thing, another thing that I look for is where is the corral at? Usually a lot of them are away from the house in the dark. And that's one thing I tell them is try to get some light around that corral. I had spoke with the lady earlier this year, living in the springtime. She had was getting up about 3-4 o'clock in the morning, and she usually does her early run before work. And she was going outside to start the car, I believe, and she looked down right by her, by her car. She found a footprint, and that really kind of spooked her. Like, oh wow, she found a handprint on her car. And she called me out there, and I, you know, when I was making my way out to her place, I noticed the corral was far from the house in the dark. And I had asked her, I said, hey, do you have any problems with this thing bothering your sheep there? I noticed your corral is in the dark from here away from the house, like in the corner here, you know, right as you're pulling up. And she goes, yeah, she said, last summer that one of their sheep was the head of the sheep was ripped off of his body.
What?
And that is something that, you know, the Bigfoot will do and take off with the body.
He'll just rip the head off the sheep and run off with the body? So it's kind of like as he's running, the sheep's bleeding out so he can eat it?
pretty much, yeah. I mean, I've heard a lot of that.
That's
cases like that.
The amount of strength that Bigfoot mm-hmm. would have to be able to rip a head off of a sheep, clean off of its body.
Right.
That is like unbelievably strong.
Yes.
That's
I had back in 2011. The people that I was telling you about, but the one that was sitting up in the tree, they had also, they have, horses. And one of the dad, I believe, the next morning was going to go feed the horses and came across his horse. The neck was broken, and even their little puppy. His neck was broken and thrown off to the side, too. About a week before that had happened, one of the lady knows another, a friend of hers that lives out towards, south of Farmington. She was going out to go feed her horses in the morning, like she usually does, and I believe she lives pretty close to the river. All of the horses, you know, they always meet up to this certain area where she goes and feeds them, but she noticed one of the horses was missing, didn't come back up. So she went driving around, and she found her horse along the river there, and with his neck twisted, it was broken. The horse was dead.
What the hell could twist? That's unbelievable. It even could manage to break the neck of a horse. I mean,
right.
Some people I know, some listeners don't have never stood next to a horse before, mm-hmm. or even a sheep before, but so they don't understand the amount of strength. I mean,
we have this going on out here.
I didn't think anything like this happened. I thought Bigfoot was basically vegetarian.
No.
I thought that it hid in the woods and didn't ever come around people. I'm finding out everything that I thought about Bigfoot was wrong.
No, there's so many people out there that think that they're the, you know, like you say, vegetarian, no, they eat meat too. You know, they do. And
so is there any truth to the stories like over in Tibet? There's the stories of how Bigfoot will take women and rape them, and the women will end up having Bigfoot children?
That's what I hear. I've heard that before, and I do believe that does happen. It's happened. There was an incident that did happen out here, but it's been kept very quiet. That's why I tell the ladies to be very careful out there, anywhere, not just here, not just on the reservation, but everywhere, because they do, like I say, they do observe the women, and they could be possibly getting ready to kidnap one. But I do believe that happens, yes, I do, and whether people believe it or not, you know, that's their own opinion.
I believe you. I don't think I have any reason not to believe you. Last week, we had someone on the show talking about what I believe was a skinwalker. It was a lichen, you know, the werewolf. Uh-huh. And this week I have you on here talking about Bigfoot. And lichen, the lichen, even though the lichen's supposed to be 7, 8, 9 foot tall or something like that, mm-hmm. didn't do the damage that you're telling me that Bigfoot does do, because mm-hmm. the only thing I've ever I've been told that Bigfoot will uproot a tree, flip it over, and roots will be where the treetop should be, and the top of the tree will be stuck back into the hole. I have witnessed that. I've never mm-hmm. ever seen Bigfoot, and up until now I've always wished that I could. I don't think I even want anything to do with a Bigfoot now.
Yeah, it's scary. You know, I've seen a lot of things that it can do, and it is. You know, it's real. You know, there's so many skeptical people out there, people that make fun of, you know, the Bigfoot. You know, you really need to stop and be careful what you say. Don't make fun of these people. It's real. These things are really happening. You know, until they see it with their own eyes, then will they know that it is going on.
If you want to call,
it's real. It's real.
I believe you that it's real. If you want to call into the show and talk to Brenda and ask her a question, just call 1-419-464-7272. This I'm still trying to wrap my head around this, Brenda.
Yeah.
A horse Bigfoot snapped a horse's head, and a Bigfoot is yes. the only thing I know of that is big enough to even have the opportunity to snap a horse's neck. I mean, there's nothing that big. A big cat in Africa doesn't snap a horse's neck. A crocodile no. doesn't snap a horse's neck. I mean, that to think of the size, I'm 6 foot tall. All right, I've got mm-hmm. decent sized hands. How big are these handprints?
The one that I've measured so far was, I believe, let me think, it was 9 inches. I'll have to go back to my notes and check for sure. I think it was 9 inches long, I believe. It was pretty big. I was like, wow. That is huge. Let's see. Oh, I smell something out here.
I couldn't imagine something.
It must be coming up. I can actually smell something coming up.
Really?
I can smell a skunky smell. Right now.
The skunk ape. Oh, that's.
And my dogs are really quiet.
Oh, that's not good. You do got all the lights on in the house, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You got a gun?
Oh, yeah. I always have that. Well, oh, boy, that smell is getting really strong. Hold on just a minute.
Yeah, yeah. Well, this is interesting, guys. Just like always on this show, you start talking about something and it appears, you know.
Yeah, I can hear the dogs barking from the distance. But yeah, it must be around because I can smell it. So well, my dogs are really quiet. Wow. Well, it's around somewhere. But yeah, we've been having some activity, and I know it's been around. It comes through our property quite a bit.
Well, if it's passing through, wish it luck, you know? I mean, but if it's just passing through and it doesn't want to do you any harm, that's good. I mean, how about doing things like burning sage? I mean, that smell would be enough to, it's potent enough to want to, like, make anything leave that doesn't like that. I mean, it's just an idea.
Oh, yeah. I understand. Well, yeah, we have a lot of things, you know, that's going on here, and a lot of the reports that I've been getting in quite a bit now, a lot more, is it's looking in the windows. And you'll leave a handprint, or sometimes when it's at south, I'll see its face looking in the window, and they can see red eyes.
It's becoming
bold.
The
eyes is red, that it's, you know, it's looking in. And
what about an electrified fence? Do you think that would stop it?
I'm sorry?
An electric fence, do you think that would stop it?
Yeah, I don't think so. It'd probably just give them a little buzz, and that's it, and they'll still keep coming in.
Really? It wouldn't be enough to say, nope, go somewhere else?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's just like a little shock, and, you know, unless it's high voltage, then yeah, it would stay out.
But high voltage would also kill your animals.
Oh, yeah.
You don't want to kill your
animal.
You can't have that.
No. No. Not that. Yeah, those are, you know, the things that I share with you are the things that I share with the people, that they could, you know, do some of these things.
Well,
also, if they have, like, tall weeds. So I'm, like, about 5'2", 5'3", and I've walked into some weeds that are taller than me.
Right.
And, you know, from looking from the outside, it looks like there's nothing, you know, it's all just the weeds. But if you were to actually go in the inside, walk inside those weeds, you'll find a lot of bedding in there. And I took, you know, a lot of pictures of those, and I tell the people, hey, get that cleaned out of there, because they are making beds in there. And I said, okay, let's go. I'll show you what I'm talking about. And I'll take them in there, and lo and behold, there's bedding in there. And I said, you need to get rid of these weeds. Also, you know, we have a lot of, like I said, cottonwood trees. And sometimes a lot of the people, they won't maintain the trees, the bottom trunk of the tree from the ground. There's always a lot of weeds. I always tell them, get that cleaned up so you can see past that.
Right.
The trunk of the tree. You know, that way you have good vision. Clean all of that up. Another thing is your trash can. If you don't burn your trashes, or, you know, haul your trash and, you know, try to keep it cleaned out as much as possible, because they're digging in your trash can for food.
Right. Have you spoke with the elders at all about this? I mean, the reason I ask is because I would think that there is old Navajo ways to keep Bigfoot from coming around the tribe.
I have, and a lot of them, you know, they say that they bring, some of them, they'll say that they're here to bring, like, the rain, you know, kind of like to bless the land and stuff. And I get some other elders that will say they're no good, you know, they're evil, they're demons, and, you know, they're you need to stay away from them and pray them off, you know, so they won't come around. You know, I always get, like, different views from each elder. It's always different.
You haven't happened to talk with the medicine man about this problem, have you?
No. I don't really believe in the medicine man, because, you know, I don't mean no disrespect to all of the natives out there that's listening. I had been sung over when I was at a young age. I had something supposedly that was done to me to make me sick. And if you know what I mean, in the culture,
yeah, I know.
sometimes, you know, you get somebody else that's trying to do something to you, so they call a medicine man in. Well, I have my mom and dad at that time had brought in a medicine man because I was getting sick or something, if I can remember. But I was watching this medicine man, and he was, you know, getting all his stuff together, his little pouch and his feather, and they boil up some water, remember, and they made me drink this, what they call peyote.
Yeah.
And he went off into our bedroom, into the bathroom, and what made me kind of follow him, I don't know why, but the door was open, and the bathroom door was open, and I remember watching him from behind. I was watching what this guy was doing, and he took this pouch out of his pocket, and what he took out of this little pouch was little pebbles of rocks, and he stuck it in his mouth underneath his tongue. I was just standing there watching him, and like, what's he doing? Why is he putting that? You know, so I hurry and turn around. I walk back into the kitchen, and he comes out, and I remember my dad put me on the counter, and they told me to drink that stuff, so I drank that, and it was nasty.
Oh, yeah,
young of age, it's like, yuck, you know. You know, I drank some of that, and he started doing his, you know, singing and doing his feather thing, and then he started sucking on my neck, and I'm like, sitting there, and like, what's he doing? You know, and a few minutes later, he goes, this is what I took out of your neck. He spits it out, and it was those pebble of rocks that he put underneath his tongue. I watched him put those in his tongue. Ever since then, I looked at him. You're a hoax. You're not a real medicine man. You just taking, you know, my mom and dad's money. That's all you want is the money. So ever since then, I don't really, you know, go to the medicine man because a lot of them are only in it for the money.
Right, right. I was just thinking that maybe the medicine men would have ways of deterring the Yeti, the Bigfoot, and mm-hmm. and something they might be able to tell you, something that you could do that's not going to cost you any money to
right.
keep them away. I mean, it seems to me that they, above everyone else, would know that sort of an answer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, what do I know? So
right, you know, a lot of the times when I go out and do these investigations before I leave the family, I will stop and I will ask them, may I pray with you? I do. I do believe in God. I'm not ashamed to say that. I'm a believer in God. I usually always say a prayer with them. And when I say a prayer with them, I'll call them, you know, a couple of days later. I'll go back over there and visit. And I'll ask them, you know, has it been back around? No, not ever since you prayed. You know, it seems like it went away, you know, for a while. You know, eventually, you know, it comes back every now and then, but not like it used to. So I do, you know, I'll say a little prayer with these, with the family before I leave.
Whatever works for you.
It works, you know, it does. You know, God's very powerful, and, you know, he's my protector when I go out there. Many people ask me, how can you go out there all by yourself sometimes and, you know, and check on the people? And I always look, you know, and I always tell them, you know, God is my protector. He's the one that is shielding me from these things. And I know he'll watch over me and take care of me when I'm out there. And I leave at that. And I always tell him also, just because I believe in God doesn't mean that I'm going to go out there with a bad attitude, like, oh, I'm all bad and, you know, these things aren't going to hurt me because I have God in my heart. No, I don't go out there like that. They can still hurt me, so I still have to be careful myself as well.
I would say that's more faith than it is anything else.
Mhm. Yeah, but, you know, that's all I have is faith, my faith in God, and, you know, he's like I said, he protects me
well,
when I'm out there. And, you know, late at night, a lot of the people, and I always share this on different shows, that I go out there driving around the community in other people's community far, about 10, 20 miles from where I live, about 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, just driving around the neighborhood, making sure, you know, they're okay and stuff. And I don't ask for gas money. I don't ask for help. I do it because I care and I don't want anybody to get hurt. Sometimes I'll take my son with me or one of the guys, my other teammates that aren't working, they'll tag along with me. We'll be driving around, you know, really late at night, early in the mornings. The latest I got home in the morning was probably between 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning. Now, you know, I'm just driving around making sure, you know, they're all okay. I don't want to see anybody get hurt from this, you know, from the Bigfoot roaming their area or their animals, you know. So many people have lost a lot of livestock because of it and because of something else that's out there, you know. And that's what I do. I just care a lot for the people. People say, oh, you're making a lot of money off of this. No, I'm not. I'm not, you know, and I'm not in it for the money. I don't care, you know, how much I don't care about that. It's not about the money. It's not about me. It's about the people and their safety.
Well, I thank you for coming onto my show and saying things that happen on the reservation that normally would not be told.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I feel privileged.
You're welcome. You know, a lot of this, and there's more things that I kept very quiet that, you know, so many people out there don't even know, you know, and those things are kept very quiet.
Right.
And in time, I'll share those things with you.
Well, that's totally up to you. I don't want to try to force mm-hmm. you to talk about anything, especially anything mm-hmm. that's sacred to you and your people, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. Without, you know, I don't want you in trouble for saying things you're not supposed to say. I do mm-hmm. know how it works.
I understand.
Huh?
I understand.
Yeah. I'm just letting you know I understand how it works. And mm-hmm. and I, you know, I don't want to like put you in and get you in trouble.
Right.
Where I live, they call it the Black Swamp. It used to be swamp. They drained 150 square miles of swamp and put cities here. The energy is still here, and every once in a while you see things and you find things that's kind of unexplainable. And I have heard tell of Bigfoot being around here, though it's beyond me why people would say Bigfoot would be here when there's really nowhere they could live. There's mm-hmm. you know, out east in Cleveland. I'm in Toledo. And uh-huh. out in near Cleveland, Ohio, there's all kinds of state forest and things like that, and there's space for Bigfoot to live. But here it's like, huh? There's nowhere. It's like I don't even understand how the deer population that we have can live here, because there's next to no place for the deer to live. Everything is all houses except for out where I'm at. But anyway,
you know, as long as there is a stream of water, it could be the smallest stream, they will always follow. Every animal will follow that stream of water. The same with the Bigfoot. It could be just trickles of water, and they will follow that to the biggest water.
Will they?
To the biggest river. Mm-hmm. As long as there is water around, they will follow that stream.
So as long as there's
along a place that stream, there's always going to also be food.
And a place to hide.
Exactly.
that kind of makes me wonder, because around here you smell skunk weed all the time. And mm-hmm. I wonder if it's not just skunk weed, but something else.
yeah, the smell over here right now is gotten stronger. So I'm going to probably get ready to go okay. kind of walk around outside with my son and see.
All right.
Yeah, pretty soon when we're done here. So.
All right. Well, I've got. It's 4 minutes to 12 from what I got, and then, so. This is what we'll do. Give me your website again and how to contact you. Okay. Give my listeners that.
Okay. My hair, my email address is harrisbrenda46@yahoo.com. And you can also find me on Facebook. And we have a YouTube channel. Our YouTube name is New Mexico Shadow Seekers.
Awesome. That's great, man. All right. Thank you very much for being on the show.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me on.
Well, you're very welcome, and we will have you on again. I promise next time it won't be so long.
Oh, no problem. No problem.
So that way, you know, yeah. All right. Well, you have a good night, and take care. The podcast will be up tomorrow, and I'll give you the link to that through Facebook, and I will talk to you later. You have a good night. See you. Bye.
You too. Thank you very much. Good night.
And there you have it, guys. There is my show for the evening. It was about Bigfoot. It was about what's going on with our country at the moment. There was a few mishaps, but we got through them. We always do. I have to thank PSN and Angel. And there's always a curveball with things, but we got the show done. So you guys, be well, be safe. Don't do anything that I wouldn't do. And if you do, don't get caught and don't hurt anybody. I'm going to close the show with a song by Brian Henke. It's called Magic Spell, Mist of the Moon. And until next week, I will see you. Bye.
Mysteries.